All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Conradio. I'm Conrad. This is Shannon.
Hello.
And as part of our learning about small business episodes, we were able to get in touch with Isaac and Paris from SheDoesTaxes.com. Isaac, Paris, how are you?
Hi, guys.
Great. Thank you guys for having us. We are really, really happy to be here.
You bet.
Thanks for coming on. Now, obviously, this is, if you've listened to our show over the past 10 years, you know we've had some issues with taxes, meaning we have no idea what we're doing. So this will be very informative for us.
Yes.
Well, I tell you what, we all have, I'm sure if you rewind the tape way back, we've all had our different struggles with taxes. And, you know, it doesn't matter how big or small your business is, or if you're just a personal, don't have business, you know, you got to do your taxes. That's important. You know, you can get audited at any time, and that's embarrassing, and it might cost you some money, and it's scary. That's another thing that people know about taxes. Everybody, you know, doesn't like really like to admit they don't like the IRS, but it's still a part of life, and it's an important thing.
But and I think one thing that happens is, for me, you don't know where to start if you need tax help. So you don't even know who to trust because it's something that's so personal. You don't know who to trust.
That's right.
Like you don't even want to walk into a tax office because you're going to give them your life.
Your whole life.
Yes.
So you are so right. Yeah. And I can't wait until we get into a story. I have something so interesting to tell you guys about trust. I can't wait to come back
into it. Let's get into it. Get right into it.
People trust you.
So I'll go ahead and get started. I'm Paris, of course. I'm the She and She Does Taxes. This is actually my business partner slash husband, right?
Okay.
So he's the guy in the chair. Without him, I could never have scaled this business as big as I did. I could have never been as professional as I am and had these things put together, calendars and such, right? Those things, I'm all over the place. I talk a lot. I'm crazy. So he keeps me organized and it works so well. So we built a brand out of that and it's wonderful. So either way, I come from Houston, Texas. Right now we're living in, living near Oklahoma City in a small town. And so we love it here, first of all.
I was born in Ada though, just so that.
Oklahoma original.
Real Okie.
Oh, in Ada, Oklahoma? Yeah, you're an Okie then.
Yeah, we sold some tacos in Ada, sure.
Really? Good. Yeah, we got the chance to go back and visit his hometown, and it was nice and cute.
Yeah, it was cute.
I come from Houston, like I said. I don't know anything cute and nice like that. I know big buildings.
Okay, well, so I'm going to tell you this. You're used to the heat then. You're used to this heat right now because Houston, it's like this is a normal day in Houston.
It's terrible. It is a normal day in Houston, and it's a normal day in December in Houston.
Yeah. So that's true.
That's right.
We definitely wore shorts. For Christmas.
Yeah.
So, it was terrible. But either way, I come from Houston where this industry is a little bit different. I will say that preparing taxes was something I got into as a young girl. I loved accounting as I was young. And throughout high school, I was a part of the accounting team, actually, and brought home trophies, right, for my presentations, crap like that. It was wonderful.
Yeah.
But coming from a family that didn't really, you know, I don't know if anybody really went to college in my family. I didn't really know what my next step was after high school. It was strange, I know, but follow me. So I'm going to school. I'm doing this program. I'm having a great time. And I'm thinking to myself, what am I going to do after high school? I have no idea. Nobody's talking to me about college. My friends are going. They're fine. I don't know what the heck I'm going to do. So either way, I'm doing this whole thing. And my accounting teacher comes in. She's like, you don't need to be a CPA. You don't need to go to college. You don't need to become an enrolled agent. Here's what you need to do. You need to get a preparer's tax identification number for free at the IRS.
Yeah.
Go to their website and sign up. You're not a felon, so you'll get it.
And so, that's important,
I got it, right? And then I found a company to work for. 18 years old, fresh out of high school. I found a company to work for. They taught me the ropes. They taught me some don'ts. They taught me some do's, right? Mm-hmm. So I learned a whole bunch, and I got a chance to work really close with the owner.
Well, you learned more than what you'd learn in college.
Oh, for sure.
I went to college, and I learned nothing in accounting class. I mean.
I think what I learned was how to run a business.
Mm-hmm.
How to stay dedicated, right? And what it takes and how to show up even though you don't feel like it, because nobody's going to do it for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, those are the things I learned. But either way, I'm getting into this trusting with you guys, with this industry. Mm-hmm. So I'm working under this person, and I'm getting clients because I'm very heavy on social media. I love Facebook. I love interacting on Instagram. It's natural for me. It's not even a push. And so either way, I get a lot of clientele. And in my first year, I kind of bag about 50 plus clients.
Wow.
And I helped this woman. Yeah, it was wonderful. And I've never seen anything like it until my first year in my own firm, where a young woman prepared over 200 returns in her first year. And wow. So, yeah.
I repaired one and wanted to jump off.
Me too. I think I halfway did mine and just gave it to her.
Yes. That's actually how we met.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
Yeah.
I'm kidding. That's funny. No, I started preparing his taxes probably a few months after meeting him. He is a very secure person. And like you said, you have to be trustworthy.
Well, Conrad knows this. Conrad knows this about me. What attracts me to a woman is not only can she cook, but can she do tax?
Right.
That's true.
So I'm going to tell you that right now. If I got those two, I got to lock them down. That's right. So Isaac's already a smart man in my book. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
Isaac is a genius. Okay.
Yeah, my wife can cook, but does not do taxes.
Not tax.
And that's sad.
No.
But I'm thinking, you talked earlier before we started the interview that you also have a program where you're hiring women to help you too.
So I wanted to get into that, but I wanted to finish the story about trust.
Yes.
So
okay, you guys, I'm long-winded, so follow me. So either way, I'm working at this office. I'm doing the sweeping. I'm doing the organizing. Clients are coming in. They're not mine. I'm seating them. I'm getting their paperwork started. I'm going the whole nine. I'm becoming this person's assistant. I'm doing everything for them. So a couple weeks pass, and in the tax industry, there's something you have to understand. The IRS doesn't start paying out until February. We start working in January.
Right.
So a whole month, there's nothing. You're working to see nothing. But come March and come April and come May, that's when the thousands start to roll in, right?
So
during January, if you're in a tough spot, it might be a tough business for you.
Right.
So either way, that was me. I was young. I wanted a car. I wanted an apartment. I wanted everything. And I couldn't wait. And so either way, I went to her, and she was supposed to be paying me to be her assistant, roughly about $300 a week, just, giving it to me for me to come in and help her. I hadn't seen anything for that month of January. And I was 18 and very timid. And even to this day, I'm still timid about money, which is kind of funny. So I wanted to ask her about it. And it didn't go well. And so all of my clients, all of the money that I had worked for, I didn't get it. I didn't get it. And if I could be honest with you guys, it was well over $20,000 in commission that I was supposed to receive. And she had stolen it from me.
Oh.
And so from that moment on, I said, no way. I will not work for another tax office. It doesn't matter what they do. It doesn't matter, how cheap the software is.
Yeah.
Nothing like that. I'm going to have my own show, like Conrad.
Sure.
Yeah.
I'm going to have my own show, and I'm going to have to rock it. But I run into some issues. But that is the trust part.
Yeah.
I thought I could trust that woman.
Yeah.
And when I shared my story online, I came to find out that so many people had the same exact thing happen, where they were promised a certain commission and didn't get it. So a part of signing up to work with me is that I promise to pay. And I have contracts that I am tied to with that, because that's the one thing that I won't tolerate at all. And so
ahead. You're speaking from the business owner side of it, the tax preparer side of it. But also there's a anxiety that you have as another looking for somebody to help you prepare your taxes. And so we've had that conversation. When we started the taco truck, it's like, I've done my taxes for when I had just a normal job, but then I also had my own business. And so I prepared those and kind of learned through my father-in-law. He was a CPA for a big corporation. So he kind of helped me through some of the programs. I was like, this is easy. But then once we started doing the taco truck in a completely new industry. In a new state.
Right.
And a partnership, which I'd never done before. And all these different things.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, dude, I can't. this is not how I've ever done it. And so I don't know what I'm doing, but I don't know who to ask.
We would have, we'd have 3-hour phone conversations, you know, and we would run through it. You know, of course, this is when we were living a little bit further away from each other, but you know, we'd have, and I finally, I broke down. I said, Conrad, we got to pay somebody, you know, we got to get somebody to do this. And the reason is it was driving him batty.
Yeah.
I mean, batty. Yeah. And I felt so
bad
because
my numbers, we can't.
Yes. According to our bank account, we can't afford to pay anybody. You know, and I felt so bad for him. And it's like, do I jump in? You know, I'm trying to jump, but he's already so far down the rabbit hole. Yeah. I would be more of, you know, a pain in his side because he's like, well, you don't have time to catch up. I'm already way ahead of trying to get these taxes done. And like I'm so old, I can't really remember too much what it was like to be 18, but $20,000 to an 18-year-old, you might as well just say that's a $1 billion.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I just cannot, that's crazy.
It hurt me.
Yeah.
It turned me into a person that, I mean, I'm traumatized.
Yeah.
Right? I just,
for sure.
Been burned.
Yeah. There's no way you could be. You could be, yeah.
Yeah. I just won't go back, and I've built an entire company based off of that. And
well, how long have you been doing this then?
I've been doing this for about 6 years.
Okay.
Having my own firm since 2020.
Okay.
Yep. Having my own firm since 2020. Yeah, it's been wonderful.
Tell me you love it.
I love it.
Okay.
I love it. Oh, yeah. Good. I wouldn't change it. Absolutely.
Well, have you had any clients that you're like, sir, you can't just bring me, this is nothing, I can't do anything with this? Because we'll probably be those kinds of clients.
Yep. That's us.
It's like a written piece of paper. Yes. I spent $13 yesterday.
Right. In crayon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have had some very, very interesting clients. One of them was an interesting situation where he was about 20 or so years old. And then his wife was about 60. Or so years old, and
60
so I
or
had
16.
60.
Okay.
Okay.
Both were bad.
Yeah. Hello. Yeah. Both are not good.
So you know, as I'm going through the documentation,
wait, what is his wife?
His wife. He remembers because I haven't. I've been working.
He likes fine wine.
He does.
Oh, yeah. For sure. For sure. Lord.
So yeah, it was very interesting. And when I had to give that call, because I'm looking at driver's licenses here and I'm looking at his application.
Yeah.
And it says spouse. And I'm like, you sure this isn't your mother? Because you know it's certainly possible to claim your parents who are older and living with you as dependents. And so I could do that, right? Mm-hmm. So I had to ask, how should I file this? Is she really your spouse? I didn't see any income, or is she your dependent? She was his spouse. And not only that, they ended up claiming her sister as a dependent. So some people have some strange situations. But
did her paperwork say anything about being on the Titanic?
Yeah, right.
Did you read that? I don't know.
Yeah.
I knew something was weird.
Hey, everybody has their own thing, and I'm not one to judge. You know, I mean, that's just if you're love is strange anyway. We all know that. We've all got those stories for being sex.
Yeah.
You know. So, you know what? She probably cooks, but guess what? She don't do taxes because he had his taxes
born
done.
Before they exist.
That's right. She doesn't understand what taxes are.
Well,
oh man, that is. Jeez. I mean, she didn't have an income. So,
right.
You know what I mean? Yeah, she didn't even have an income.
Not
but
sure
that's okay.
On,
he was bringing in the bacon.
Okay.
He was a young guy and he was cooking it up.
Wait. He was bringing it in for the older lady.
Yeah, and
this
her sister.
Like
see, no, I'm with Isaac. I would be thinking that he got a sugar mama somewhere.
Yeah.
You know, that's what I was thinking.
No, I'm not sure if that was the case.
Okay.
I'm not sure if that was the case. Yeah. But he's a good client. I work with him every year.
Yeah. Well,
love you, bud.
Because I'm so unfamiliar with having help doing the taxes, and I've just used the same TurboTax and the same stuff. I do have to buy it because we have to buy the business package every year.
The business suite,
whatever. So,
suite.
Like, what is
Right.
What could a client or a potential client of yours expect to pay for your services? I mean, if it's just a normal job or if they own a business, like how do you do that?
So that's an awesome question. I'm so happy you asked, Conrad. So here we go. If you're just a basic person, right? Mm-hmm. It's just you, you're single, you're making average cash and you're paying your taxes and getting a W-2, I might file your taxes for about $50 to $99.
Okay. Nice.
Right? If we move it up a bit and you're owing at this point, you own a home, I have to file Schedule A's, we're going to have to itemize some things, and you have a small business, now we're into about $300 to about $650.
Right.
And so if you're moving forward into that, so for you guys, it seems like you may be a client that I would have to organize for. So what that means is that you guys may not know what you can do. And so with that being said, it takes a lot more time in getting you started. So that first year of teaching you how to file your taxes and what to collect and what to have for me, I may charge you a little bit more, and it may be about the $800 to about $1,200 range annually.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you want to come with me next year and you're a little bit more organized and you're just numbers on a paper for me,
sure,
I'll go down on the price. But those are my prices.
Right.
And so it varies per situation.
Well, it has
to. Have
yeah, it has to, because, you know, and I it's like us. It's mm-hmm. In my little family, you kind of look, and God bless this. If you get into a different tax bracket, you know, I mean, if there's a fear, there's a little bit of a fear that comes with that, because you're so used to, you know, this is where we're at.
I mean,
you know, we're not getting anything back, or, you know, we claim zero, so we're getting stuff back, maybe, you know, but it does with life comes with more stuff.
Yeah.
You know, we were blessed enough to buy a little piece of property. With comes that comes different tax on that property and in a different place. You know, I mean, so there's a lot of things that goes into it, and I, you know, it's hard enough to keep up with. Every little change might change what you for sure changes what you would have to do to tell me, hey, dummy, you got to pay this. You know what I mean? This is what you owe.
But you know what? You know what I think the key to everything is: what's going in, what's going out.
Right.
What's in, what's out.
Yeah.
You can keep track of what you got,
yeah,
and then you can keep track of what you spent, you're set.
For
okay?
sure.
And it's really as simple as that. And so a lot of people thinking that they need to collect receipts. I'll tell you, I haven't done a receipt dig in years since I started taxes a while back. It hasn't been done. What I encourage my clients to do is spend money on one debit card or credit card, right? Either way, one or two. It's okay if you have two. But if you want to consolidate everything and become organized and pay less on your taxes, spend business expenses one card.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
At the end of everything, print that bad boy out, give it to your tax preparer, and magic. Right.
Yeah.
So
that's what I did.
Yeah, exactly what you do. And I tell you what, there is no one on this planet. I guarantee you. Maybe you've seen it because you're in this game. You're in the tax game. This man keeps every receipt for everything.
No, I don't. But I remember everyone I lost.
I mean, he takes pictures of it. He's got a file somewhere with all of his receipts. And I don't know how many times he's been audited personally, but it feels like he's been audited every year. Because
the funny thing is, we make so little money. If they wasted their time to audit me, and usually we owe in some way at the end of the year. And a lot of times I try to offset that with investing or going down that road, so we don't have to pay into the government. We can pay into our own future. But I get so it's anxiety.
That's not how it works.
No, but I get anxiety. Like this year, we did our taxes. I'd never done a partnership before, so I knew that there was a different form that had to be filed up by a certain time.
Yeah.
In fact, I had that date. I knew the date, but we didn't have our final credit card statement to be able to, I could make sure that we're going to go through it in time. And I was fighting with Sam's Club, because we run through the Sam's Club card.
Right.
I was fighting with them, and they're like, well, it'll take 2 weeks to get you this statement. I was like, this is unacceptable. I got to send this in. And it made us late, which cost us more than we owed in taxes.
Right.
We got our bill.
Yeah.
So it was awful.
Yes. I'm very sorry to hear that. You know what would have helped, Conrad?
You.
We'll keep every month.
Yes.
Bottom line.
But if I can give you a tip, you know, because there is a process before you get to me. And so that's all on you, right? Mm-hmm. Or you can hire a bookkeeper. Like, Conrad, I don't think you need to do that because you're good already.
Don't do that.
If you could just incorporate a monthly organization to your books, it's not hard. Many people think it's hard, but it can be as simple as a notepad.
Yeah.
Right? And guess what? It's IRS approved. It's your handwriting. It's your date. It's in chronological order. It looks wonderful. It's legible. It's good.
Oh, good. Well, I do that. I mean, I do it on a spreadsheet, and I have two, but our expense spreadsheet, and I have our sales, you know, spreadsheets. So we're fine. It just, you know how, well, I'm very, we get creative, you know, so there's one side where it's business and this is fine. But then the rest of the time it's let's go do something, do these interviews or do shows or go sell tacos. And you get home and it's like, what I end up doing is procrastinating on that. And then having to sit down for one day to go over the past month or whatever, which is fine, but it's still bothersome. I get mad at myself more than anybody else would ever get mad at
me. He does. Yeah.
Take it out on you.
Well, he doesn't take it out on me. He tells me.
Yeah.
You know, and I know I'm the dummy. I'm just the dummy guy, you know, and he's got a business degree. He's a smart guy. He's done all kinds of things for his dad's business, his own business. Both were very successful. And so when we got into business together, to sell tacos and promote podcasting, promote the show mostly, you know, I said, hey buddy, you know, I'm lean on you. I'm leaning hard. And so, you know, I try to do stuff that he tells me to do or that he needs to get done, but it's all him. He's a smart guy. I'm just the dummy hanger on. You know, I'm
smart is why it's scary. That's what scares me. You know.
Yeah. Oh. I'm so sorry.
I mean, that's how I felt when I, you know, when she was first preparing my taxes, I worked for Homeland Security at the time, but I worked very early. And so I did a lot of like medical contract jobs doing like medical technician work. And honestly, I didn't even know what all 1099s, W-2s, she had to like go and search. I don't know where she found this stuff. It was honestly scary. I was like, what? My information's here and there. But, you know, she made me feel secure about the process because I just felt so stupid.
Yeah.
My shit was everywhere and I just was trying to get a refund because I knew I was paying my taxes.
And I got him one.
Right. There you go.
You know, it works. I'm not that organized in that regard. I can sit down and completely get a computer together, but I feel like she was definitely the better half in my, like, financial world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I feel it makes you feel bad, though, because you're handing stuff over. You know what I mean? I want to do stuff, but I also don't want to mess it up. I'm more afraid of messing something up. You know, and so I tried. It's kind of like, hey, if you got a house fire, are you going to ask a firefighter how to put it out, or are you going to ask a cook? Do you know what I mean?
Right.
You got to go to the professional. You got to go to someone that knows more about it because that's less of a risk. I know he doesn't feel that way. I mean, it's just the same risk, but he has to know that he's more intelligent than I am for sure about that kind of stuff. But I kept on telling him, I was like, hey, you know what? We just need to pay somebody because you're gonna blow a fuse, buddy. I was, you know, I was worried about him as far as
and I was like, take him to the hospital. And then we got a late charge, so we should have paid somebody.
That's
it would have been the same money.
You know what? I think that is funny.
Yeah, I mean that we were working on an old car that we had gotten. We're trying to fix it up for a program we're gonna launch.
What kind?
Yeah, what kind of car?
A rental car program. It's a 2002 Accord. LX.
Okay. Yeah, it's a 2002 Honda.
I think,
and then the other one.
So a sports car.
Yeah, sports car.
Yeah.
Kind of old.
Yeah, it's a V6, guys.
Yeah.
I don't know what I'm talking about, but either way, we were
throwback to our favorite movie.
Yeah.
Death. What was that movie that we liked so bad?
Which one?
Where the kid got paid. He was a basketball player and he got paid with a sports car.
Oh, Lord.
And he looked out the window and it was a Honda Accord.
It's a Honda Accord, yeah. And what are you talking about? What was it? Death Game?
Death Game.
Death Game.
Yeah. Watch Death Game.
It's free on YouTube. You got the C-grade movies.
It's an you're gonna laugh so hard when he says sports car.
Or you're gonna laugh so hard when this gal comes out the window and says, hey,
lamb stew is ready. Like,
who says
lambs?
Made your favorite.
Sounds
lamb stew.
Good. I mean, it sounds good, but this is a basketball yes. movie. Are we eating now? Right.
Or
are we
eating? Well, Michael Jordan, all his threes were Michael, you know, were just made from lamb stew. That's what he created this whole
movie. That's right.
It was an incredible movie. You'll have to watch it. But I interrupted you. I'm sorry, Isaac.
Basically we were trying to get on this car, and I know I'm supposed to be, you know, trying to be this grease monkey, getting in here, trying to, basically the wiring is funny in this car. We're trying to get its battery hooked up. I end up just blowing the battery completely. The sparks are flying. It's
oh, wow.
I hope other people doesn't see this.
Yeah,
because
I
returned that battery, and I told them something was wrong with it. And so since I had a
something was wrong
something
with it
wrong
after
with
that.
It.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
blew up.
Can you prove it? Yeah, here's a piece. It blew up.
Yeah, a piece of it. You know, it was on the roof.
Test it out.
Yeah. So at that point, we were like, I don't know anything about cars. You got to take it to the professional. Like,
yeah.
YouTube University can only take you so far.
Yeah, we ended up having to take it to a guy because we were trying to do in the battery zone in the first
right.
place. Is that we were trying to install our own GPS tracking and kill switch on our cars.
Right.
Oh, okay.
And so, yeah.
Too much work.
We were scared.
It's not like the movies. It's not like the movie. You don't just scooch under the car and put like a little magnet under it
actually,
and you're good.
Do they?
Yeah. Okay. All right.
They do have
it.
It
was
now.
Actually pretty
not
bad.
That
we went in through the radio, guys. And so, a bunch of wiring and stuff. And so, having to strip some off and making sure that the right one is too much.
Nonsense.
Yeah.
Well, if anybody's ever just installed an aftermarket stereo, I mean, you can very easily burn
I remember the 90s.
Yeah.
You know, I remember the face plates you take out so you don't get the stereo stall. I remember that.
Yep.
I'm old enough to remember that.
Absolutely.
I think you paint them to look like wood, and then people don't think that you have a stereo. Or you
right.
paint it to look like the dash.
I'm old enough that I remember when radios were wood, dude.
That's
you know
true.
What I mean?
Old,
so
dude.
That happens.
What, I actually have a question. What was the process like in you guys renovating the Airstream that y'all,
boom.
You know?
You've just opened a whole can of worms.
No,
Isaac.
I watched stuff like that on YouTube.
We saw hourless
food.
Yeah.
So,
we
looked
at the pictures. We saw that it had been sitting for 40 years.
Yeah.
And then you guys were able to repurpose
that's
it and give it a second life. That's awesome.
Yeah. It was a ridiculous idea. And really, we didn't know we were going to go that way with it. We thought, let's go get a brick and mortar.
Right.
Because the whole idea was if we could set up our show in a brick and mortar, people would come in and have questions. Like, what do you guys do over here? And eventually, we'd be like, oh, just hang out. We'll do it after we're closed or whatever. And they
grab
hang
some tacos,
out and
sit down. We'll do a show.
And we'll do a show. And they can bring beers or whatever. But we, because I am so private with money and all that stuff. You know, we presented a business plan, we created one, and we went to a few banks and we tried to get a place here in town in Prague, Oklahoma, and a few other places. And every time, either the bank wouldn't give us the money, even if we thought that we had a pretty good proposal, because they didn't believe in a brick and mortar restaurant working. Or there was a couple times where we had cash offers on buildings that we were going to do. And once we made the offer, even if we didn't lowball them for what they were asking.
Yeah, we were sticker price. You want how much for this building? We'll offer you exactly what you're offering.
And we were going to believe in our project that much that we're going to put that much into it initially and still have to build it. And that person came back and wanted us to pay more. They're like, can you do 8,000 more? And it's like,
no,
dude, I'm not doing
that.
Well, we got in a bidding war and we ended up getting a bidding war. Everybody knows it's a lot of dispensaries now.
Yeah.
You can't throw a rock without hitting a dispensary.
Both of those buildings are now dispensaries.
Dispensaries, So
we can't compete with cash.
A lot of people that want just even a small restaurant or a barbecue place, or it doesn't matter what it is. You know, they try to get into a halfway decent brick and mortar, and then, you know, it might not even be set up for
a restaurant.
And they
weren't. We would have had to do the whole
process. Do the whole thing, yeah.
But so I just found that Airstream. I started looking at food trailers, and you get into a whole wormhole of there's all these Facebook marketplace or all these outfits out of Texas or out of all these different places that say we make these, you know. And then when you call, it goes to a number that's not related to the business and all.
Right.
And I was like, man, I can't screw this. I'm going to go find the coolest looking trailer and then we'll just do it ourselves. And that's how it started. Yeah. I just found that Airstream and I said, this will be cool. And we learned how to polish and we learned how to wire.
1977 31 foot Airstream trailer. It was sitting out in the middle of the field in Harper, Kansas.
Yeah.
I didn't know he was doing it. One day I woke up at the farm and I looked outside and there was this big silver thing. And I said, hey, what's that? And then he was pulling it in like, hey, here's our, restaurant. Let's get to work. Yeah, and so for 6 months in the winter, which is not the time to polish anything because it's cold. You need heat to polish aluminum, come to find out.
Yeah.
And so we ended up pulling it into a barn, making a huge fire on one side of the barn to heat up the shell to polish.
Yeah.
And so, and man, I tell you what, that stuff does not come off. It sprays everywhere. And I don't know what kind of soap we ended up using.
Yeah.
Or gasoline probably to get that stuff off.
It was just all over you. And then when we were polishing the day before we were open. We were never satisfied with how it looked.
Yeah.
And so, but
and we both had jobs. He was coming in from Kansas.
He would drive
160 miles to the farm on the weekend to polish, and then he might take
multiple times
like on
throughout the week.
Monday, I was working for OSU at the time.
I think I drove like 64,000 miles.
Yeah, to get the trailer done
in a year.
Yeah,
so just back and forth.
Yeah,
so, it was nuts. And so my tax thing. They were like,
yeah, I was gonna say,
we don't know what to do with you. You actually drove it. You should be a trucker, dude.
Now, luckily, I tracked it all, but it was, you know, they would have to be like, why would you do this to then make this little amount of money?
Yeah, to make two. That. Sorry about that.
Oh, no, we're just going to readjust a bit.
Yeah.
There we go.
Well,
there
we go. I guess to wrap up the story, we completely took out everything inside, you know, except we left the 70s bathroom because classic.
Yeah.
And, you know, redid everything, hardwood floors and electric and gas. And talk about, Isaac, you said you watch a little bit of YouTube videos. There's a guy out of Texas that does it for a living. And he's fantastic. We learned everything, you know, pretty much everything. And then.
But maybe you're like us. I can't sit there and watch somebody start to finish on their process. I'll watch like the first minute and go, I understand.
Yeah,
and then,
I can get it.
And I did
just skip to the last minute too, just to be like, let's see how they wrapped it up.
Would have turned it out, And so like, you go from the first minute where it's all painted and looks disgusting, you jump to the, you know, the sixth episode in.
Right.
Well, we had built it out. We actually built it. We talked to somebody, much like, you know, professionals like you do. And we reached out to a couple of different places and people that do this, you know, at least the polishing for a living.
Yeah.
And they said, yeah, it's going to be $8,000. Because it's 250 man hours. And we looked at each other and said, nope, we don't have that money. I mean, you're starting a business. That money has to be allocated other places. And so we did the right thing and jumped in, not knowing a thing. And it just kind of worked it out. Harbor Freight, I think, was our, Hobo Freight was our really good friend of ours, you know.
We bought all our stuff through there and
we blew up several motors. Yep. Not our fault. They, you know, if you don't run for 12 hours in really bad conditions, we don't know what to tell you, you know.
It was I don't know how we made it through. I mean, I look back at it and I don't know how.
Well, much like you guys, like Sly and the Family Stone once said, it's a family affair. So this is my cousin, actually, you know, second cousins.
Thank you.
My cousin's son.
My dad is your cousin.
Right.
Yeah.
So, but it's a family affair and we punched it out. We think we made it look good. And it's definitely original. I mean, somewhat original. I don't know how many people are cruising around selling tacos out of an old Airstream. I have no idea. But.
Right. Yeah. I've hardly seen it.
We've been to 93 towns here in Oklahoma. So we've hit towns. With a population of 100, we've had to knock on doors to sell tacos when we've come to small towns, and we love it. We steer away from festivals, really, because we like to talk to people. Yeah. You know, when they come up and eat, you know, we like to get their life story, a little bit of their life story or what they're about, maybe where they work, or, you know, how their family is. Or I think we visited every bank that got robbed back, you know, in the in the 20s here in Oklahoma.
Pretty Boy Floyd.
Oh, Pretty Boy Floyd. It was weird. We had three different towns. Yeah, and got it's people would come up and talk to us. Well, you see that bank over there? Pretty Boy Floyd robbed it back in the, you know, it's like, oh, well, that's awesome. You
I fell in love with Public Enemy.
Wow.
I love it. Yeah, yeah, I love the story. I got really, really attached to it. And John Dillinger's like, you know, I don't like to speak about criminals, you know.
But that was an interesting story.
Yeah,
yeah.
He had an interesting
life. Yeah.
Oh, every night, you know, pretty much every night when I walk through my living room, you know, the wife is sitting there watching some sort of, you know, detective murder story or or something. I understand all about that. I mean, it's so. It is fascinating.
Willie Nelson.
It's fascinating.
Willie Nelson was out there.
It is.
And so was Little Wayne.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys knew about that, but you know, if you're familiar with Little Wayne's music, he just got clean. He just paid his debt in 2019. And it had been going on since the early 2000s. I believe his first tax lien was in 2007. And so a lot of people don't even know that, you know, your favorite rapper could be dealing with these problems.
Country singer.
Well, sure. No, I remember the whole thing. I remember the whole thing with MC Hammer. He lost everything.
Yeah.
And a lot of that was due to taxes and all that stuff.
Wesley Snipes,
who actually did time.
Yeah, right.
He said he didn't believe in taxes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Guess what? The government doesn't care if you believe or not.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
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 Money.
Yeah. Money. Yeah.
That's
so
true.
You know,
well, you know, the three things you know about life that's standard for everybody. We're all more connected than we think we are, you know, is God, death, and taxes, right? That's it. Those are three things. That's
right.
It. You got to take care of those three.
That's right. Two things you got to do is pay taxes and die, so you might as well
do
them well.
You might as well pray while you're doing them both.
That's right. Well, we've actually discussed that. I don't, you know, if I go or if he goes before me, I have to read the lyrics of Lunatic Fringe, which is a one-hit wonder.
Yeah.
You know, and so I have to get up in front of the congregation, whoever comes to his funeral, if I outlive him, which won't happen, and I have to read the lyrics. So it's important to talk about those things, which you want family and friends to do, you know. I told him, take me for a long drive and just kick me out the side, because it doesn't matter, you know what I mean? That's the cheapest. You know, the cheapest.
Because
I tell you what, you know.
Gas is high, bud. I don't know, drive you that
funerals.
Long.
Funerals are a scam, I'm telling you.
No, I saw a post on Facebook that said caskets are $8,000. Y'all just throw me in the ground.
Yeah.
Bury me raw.
Exactly right. Yeah. That's the way I feel.
Yeah. Let me jump off of something. Walk, you know?
Exactly.
Right. Yeah.
Causing trouble, even you're dead.
Yeah.
Tell me about the best thing about your business, other than working for yourself and the accomplishments that come with that, and being self-motivated and helping people. What's the best thing about just having your own business and doing what you do? You know, is it I can do this and I've done it? Is it the self go get him? Is it the being able to help others? You know, before we started the interview, like Conrad said, you are nice enough to teach other women how to do what you do to further help other people in such a confusing, you know, industry for not only people but for businesses and everybody on the like. What's the best thing about having your own business and doing what you do?
So I will let Isaac go first, because I know you guys probably gathered I'm long-winded. He's a little shorter than me. So I'll let him answer first, and then I will give my answer.
Yeah, I guess we both have different tastes, too. I guess
we do different things.
You know, since I don't do tax. She does taxes. So, like, I don't do the taxation portion. So initially, she came to me kind of as an investor. And so she kind of laid out the business plans. And, of course, I had, you know, I've known her for a long time, so I was really close to, you know, kind of the ups and downs that she experienced, like working in the tax industry amongst other people. But, you know, I was in healthcare at the time because I figured people are always going to get sick, so I'll always have a job. And people are always, government's always going to need taxes. So it was an industry that I could really see some life in. And really, you know, seeing her fire and, you know, I wanted to get married to her at the time. So, I really saw a lot, you know, of a promising future, you know, in that regard. And her main drive, she didn't say, hey, I need to make a bunch of money, even though we needed some. Her main thing was, I want to create a positive image and a positive space for people to do something everybody hates, which is taxes.
Yeah,
but
right.
Now she's done taxes in a way that's made people like love taxes. And I feel like I get to invest and have the opportunity to invest in that work in something that helps a lot of people and helps people, because taxes, you know, if you don't know it, it can, you know, pardon my French, but it can really screw your life up.
For
you
sure.
know, it can mess shit
For
up.
Sure.
Yes.
So helping these people and being able to help people on the other end, help their own communities, et cetera, is really, really cool. And
yes.
I felt like I invested in something good as opposed to like investing in missiles or
crazy.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. And, you know, locking down somebody in marriage, you know, it always helps out if you're on, you're in for everything else, right? You know,
that's right. I had got to be along for the haul, so
he definitely pretty much.
Isaac, I don't want to misspeak, but I think you did a good job, man. You know what I mean? I think it worked out. You must have done something okay.
All right.
Yeah.
It's all right. It's going all right so far.
He's really the catch, though. So don't be confused. He's the real cop here. No, I'm serious. So either way, I think that getting into business was, I had no other thing to do. I worked for coffee shops.
Right.
I'm a master barista. I'm a tea master. I can make latte art. I love talking to people. It was wonderful. But I was making $9 an hour.
Yeah.
Plus tips, you know, so it wasn't working out. And I was doing that on the side while doing taxes, working for somebody else. And getting money stolen from me.
Right.
So, right. So it all, you know. But getting into this, I found it, oh man, I love the drive that it comes with. And I also love that it's seasonal. I only really work extremely hard from January through April. I get to stay home with my husband, and it has really, really helped our relationship.
Yeah.
If I was running off to a 9-to-5 every day, I don't know, you know, of course we'd probably still be married, but the bond we have from working from home and running this business together. It's stronger than I've ever seen. And we were best friends before lovers, before marriage, all of that. And so we get to capitalize on being best friends in business as well as being like married in business. It's really fun. And I love that. And I also love the camaraderie of having my ladies together. I host groups. We do marketing Mondays. I show them where to go and how to get out there. I mean, I just started doing Instagram and I'm like, in it to win it right now, getting thousands of views. And the way I'm doing it is a strategy. I'm not just waking up in the morning, you know, peeing gold. No, I'm studying this stuff.
Yeah.
And I teach them how to do it as well. And I've helped so many people, so many young women change their lives around, not just through hiring them, but through preparing their taxes for them as well.
Yeah.
So it's been on both sides. I've helped people start businesses. One lady was owning a certain business that she just was like, I'm not making any money with that. Once she introduced taxes, the tax industry gave her the income she needed to build that business. And she actually ended up going and putting her boutique into a store from the money we made together.
That's
she
awesome.
She was able to earn 5 figures in just 3 months.
Wow.
And so that I cry when I think about that because, you know, a lot of people don't come from that. And so a lot of people don't see that kind of money in their life.
Mm-hmm.
And if they have one conversation with me and I can get them, I can create that. And so
awesome.
I love that. Yeah. And I show them where to be, you know,
well,
it's
the knowledge. They might have a great idea.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the same thing. We, you know, you have an idea, a crazy idea of a business, you know, and we heard everything, you know, money, you know, food doesn't make any money, you know, but you go buy a Chick-fil-A or a McDonald's and you say, I don't know how this place doesn't make any money.
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
you know, it's packed 24/7,
yeah.
you know, and it's different for a small business that's not connected to a large conglomerate, you know, or a large corporation, but, you know, like a fast food or something like that. So it's definitely different. But, you know, when we work in the truck, we can say we can see for sure making a living out of it. We know how much the average is, even in small towns that have 200 people. You know, we've had people drive 30 miles or more, you know, just because we're out somewhat close to them.
Yeah.
And a lot of it's word of mouth.
Sure
of course.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you guys are 30 miles away, we definitely stop by for sure.
We'd probably have one taco too many.
Yeah. Well, there's no such thing of that. There's no such thing of that.
Yeah. That's
true. One taco,
I think it just depends on the person's goals, you know, when they start the business. So
ours
was, we can see visions to, you know, better ways to make more money,
right?
But that didn't necessarily align with what we like to do. We like to sit there and talk to get to know people, meet people. And so it's like, let's just start doing more interviews and meeting people instead of driving to the town, hoping that we meet them
right.
and then maybe not meeting. And so opening this side of our business up, you know, to talk to business owners in the area, or doesn't really matter, comedians, whoever we talk to, all we're doing is spreading who we are anyways. That's so it. We can do it a lot cheaper than driving around.
For sure.
A lot less sweaty too. This time.
And what you were talking, what you were talking about is helping people that don't know is what I was getting at. Cause we, you know, he struggled with the taxes and you don't know. And it's not the fact that you're at the loopholes. It's just the information of how it's done. If you can, you know, if you're taking, if you're taking a certain difference, because you know, a different business, different state, they have different things. You never know what you're missing out on, or the money you're leaving on the table. You could be paying all your taxes and being straight with the IRS, but you don't know, hey, this is a deduction.
Yeah.
What are you doing?
Yeah.
You know, you got to get this back, or you got to get this off your taxes. And you, and the having knowledge, as you guys, I'm sure know, knowledge is power, and being able to help other people, understand that. And it sounds like you have with several people, about, hey, you got to deduct this. This is money that's yours. You've already paid it in this, this, and this.
Yeah.
So it's not, you know, and the same thing, I told you guys, I was blessed enough to get a small piece of property here. And, you know, we got into, basically, to where we're tax exempt. I didn't even know this was a thing, you know? So this surprised me. So if you have a section of acreage, it's a little bit, and it's set either for livestock or hay or something that you do, even if you're sharecropping, you can get in tax exempt. And I'm going to tell you what, that surprised the heck out of this guy, you know, because now I go and buy something for the farm I'm tax exempt guy.
Yeah.
So, you know, when I look at something, especially with the prices going up and everything, I go buy maybe some 2x4s to repair the old barn, and that sticker price they've got, that's what I'm paying because I'm not paying any extra taxes. It's amazing.
Gotta love it.
And I wouldn't know that. I just wouldn't know that.
Yeah.
It's your math a lot
easier.
That's
good. And I'm so happy that you brought up the word loophole. I struggle with that word because what we do is not loophole.
Right.
Right? We're meeting the standards of the IRS. And so, you know, if you're a taco truck, it's very important that you know what you're spending your money on, every little thing, right? And so definitely go down the list of every which way you're spending your money, and you'd be surprised.
Yeah.
Even things that require you to entertain your guests or entertain yourselves even, like subscriptions and things like that.
Right.
Those little small things can make a big difference in taxes.
I always viewed, like, after doing a lot of research and, like, hearing on, you know, doing research for hours and hours, all I hear about is taxes, and I did not care about them before. I really now relate tax preparers kind of like lawyers. I mean, I've gotten a speeding ticket or two, and I feel like my ticket was $250, but somehow my lawyer got me out for $50, and it wasn't on my record. Well, wonderful, because I wasn't going that fast, maybe.
Right.
Tax preparer is the same thing. They just understand the law, I think, to help you maximize your financial situation, and I'm all for it. I don't want tickets, and I don't want to pay too many taxes.
Exactly. No, that's right, and that's why I say information is key. I don't want to use that, and I know in the tax world, like much other world, loopholes is a bad word, but it's the fact that if you know you're going to a professional that it does this for a living, and they know everything and what the government owes you know, and what they can do for you. And if you don't know that, you could be us dummies out here running a business and leaving $6,000 or, you know, heck, even $100 on the table at the end of the year.
Yeah.
That sure does help out. That helps us get to the next step.
You know what? Some people aren't aware too. I think a lot of people don't know the difference between what's deductible and what is considered a credit.
Right.
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 So there are many, many delicious, big, juicy credits that the IRS gives out. Right. Mm-hmm. First thing you want to do, have a baby.
Yeah. Right. Right. Yeah.
That is a nice
one. I've got two of them. Yeah. And some things about that's fun.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Okay.
Right. I'm just saying. Not all and, so, and so if you want to figure out a way to get some money, right that's going to be your first step. If I can be honest with you guys, the IRS was doing something called the Advanced Child Tax Credit. Mm-hmm. You know, are you guys familiar with those advanced payments that people were getting on the children?
Yeah. This guy
some people were getting, you know, three children under the age of 7 years old. That's $900 a month. So they were doing that.
Wow.
Yeah. And so many people thought what they thought. It was so funny. So what they thought was, when I file my taxes, I'm going to have to pay that back. And I'm thinking to myself, no, the child tax credit in the previous year was $1,400. Mm-hmm. So you guys per child. Okay. Mm-hmm. So we're just talking about 1 unit of child here. That's $1,400. If you go to 2021, which was the last year we just filed, mm-hmm. it increased to $3,600, and they gave advance payments of half of that.
Wow.
So you still had the same deduction, right?
Did you lose or did you, right?
Yeah.
And so it was so interesting to see many people not understand that.
Yeah.
And so they were saying, you know, I'm supposed to get 10 grand back, but I'm only getting six. Why is that? Well,
you already got it.
You already got it.
For sure.
And so they're like, oh, now I have to pay it back. And I'm like,
no.
All right. Right. Well, nice doing business with you, and I'll see you next year for sure.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, $900, and even today, I mean, that's at least a tank of gas. You know what I mean?
Right.
I mean, that's, you know, geez.
Yeah.
You can either buy a house or
get a tank of gas. Sure, right.
Yeah.
It does surprise me, though. It definitely does surprise me. Some people don't know about those credits.
Yeah.
And there's many of them, not just
That's the thing. You're in it and you see it and you learn about things as you go because you're around it. And so that's better serving your customers that come to you because I'm not paying attention to this. You know,
he's not.
And no one is. And I don't pay attention to much.
I'll get excited when they say our dogs and puppies can be dependents. Then I'll finally.
I think that if it's a service animal, I don't see how you can't say it's a
true.
Dependent.
That's
I mean,
right.
If it's providing a service.
They don't have a social. They don't
have a social. We need.
If they had a puppy,
social security number.
Yeah, but you know what? A lot of people think that it just is another way to go about it. Okay? There's just another way to go about it. And that's all I'm going to say about that. But all of the different things that come along with a dog could be tax deductible if you play your cards right.
Yeah, depending on what your dog is used.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
How do we get people in touch with you that either need your services or want to work with you or for you? Or
they need your services. Let's just put that out there. Everybody's listening. You're going to need their services.
Well, I will say that we are optimized. And so if you search Sheeta's Taxes, you will find us on Instagram, TikTok, Pinterest, Google,
Facebook,
anywhere you
Instagram.
Look. Our website is www.sheetastaxes.com.
Yeah.
All of our information is listed there. You can request to speak with me directly. I'm a very friendly girl and I love taxes, right?
Awesome.
And so any question is a good question.
Yeah.
And that's where you'll find us.
Yeah.
For sure. Everything is there. I am working on a new website. So the design that you guys are going to see is going to be a little bit more of my last year's design.
Huh.
I'm planning to bring forth some blogging and a little bit more of a personal touch. And so eventually there will be a new website out there, much cleaner and more interactive.
Awesome.
And so I can't wait. You know, I'm excited to help people and I love helping people.
And
like Conrad
was
saying,
talking to
you. Yeah, it was.
Really,
but
you know,
of course, Conrad, I am a fan of yours. I love you too, Shannon. But I was looking at
no problem. He's a good
I love your marketing. I love his marketing. I love your marketing.
Yes.
I love what you're doing. I love your website. I think it's hilarious. I saw the loop comb. I saw
I'm glad people. I wish people would understand.
And that made me feel a lot more comfortable talking with you guys. You know, doing that research was necessary.
Yeah.
I was like, oh my goodness.
I'm a Luke Combs fan.
And
yeah.
I was able to look at that website. I was like, okay.
Yeah.
And then I looked at your Facebook and I was like, okay.
Yeah, everything is a, you know, it's a joke as far as you want it to go.
Right.
I mean, it could be on the surface or, And that's what we like to do. And then some people we have on here, they have no, they've not looked at anything we've done.
Which is fine. It's fine. We're here to try to help other people, and that's fine. But if they do check us out, it's kind of a little awakening when you see a post about dad knees and you don't know what that means. It's all about
it's nothing.
It's just as it's a dad's knee, you know.
Well, I appreciate it. I'm glad somebody likes the social media.
Yeah,
post.
We
love it. It is funny, and I love that. What is it called, baby? The type of marketing that you're using, there's a term for it. Irreverence.
Yeah.
That's my life. Yeah, that's for sure. Yeah. I pray for him every night.
I am trying to capture that in my own life. Hey, what are you doing? You know, you need to be following me, texting me, dummy.
Well, sometimes it's easy. I mean, don't take me wrong, it's not easy, but sometimes it's easy for us to a little bit hide behind the veil of comedy. But it is literally what we find funny, and it could be something just on the surface or something that we think that people miss. That's just the hilarity of it, or the bubbles people get in that we just try to poke and say, you know, and some people like it and some people don't, and we just throw it out there. And
well,
you know,
it's more like just don't take yourself so seriously on anything.
The world needs to laugh more. And if we just stop taking everything so serious about politics and everything else that's out there, and, you know, we're not all going to die, guys. I mean, you know, we went through a bad pandemic, but we did it together. You know, for goodness sakes, let's laugh a little bit.
Well, we appreciate you guys coming on. And we look forward to, we'll send this, I mean, this will be on YouTube, as you know. But
yeah, we're going to post today. We've got a little editing to do.
And
so
feel free to take that link. And when you're building your site, if you want to include stuff like this on your new website.
Or cut it up yourself. However you guys want to do it. It's yours. We're just trying to get the word out there. I don't want to speak for Conrad here. Best interview yet. You guys are awesome. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Really? No, really. Seriously. We had a very good time.
Yeah, we had fun. And thank you.
I just had a lot of fun as well. Here, we got somebody to introduce to you guys.
Oh, wow. Fur baby. What do we got?
Oh my. This is our new tech dog.
And that social security number is.
Yeah. What's his social security number? All right.
Lisa, what's your social barb?
that is a cute puppy.
It has been a true pleasure.
Holy cow. I just inherited, my daughter moved out and she didn't want to pay the pet fee and she got a puppy. And so I inherited another. I'm up to four now, for goodness sake. Yeah. So, of all different shapes and size. I know I got four. I got a great Dane and a couple other small. Yeah, I know. It's just, it's silly. It's silly, but that's a good looking puppy right there.
How is that? I got it.
Great Danes? They're called gentle giants for a reason. I mean, they're great with kids. It is difficult because of the size. They don't live so long, which is really hard. You get really attached and only around for 7 or 8, maybe 9 or 10 if you're lucky. But they don't live as long as other breeds. But best breed I've owned other than maybe a lab.
Yeah.
So a lab and
Great Dane. That's what I hear.
Way up there. Yeah. Yeah. I've had two. I'm on my second one now. It took a while till I got back to it. So my first one was a really big connection. When she passed, it was a little difficult, you know. But
great breed
of dog. I mean, like I said, they're lap dogs. They're 200-pound lap dogs. So if you like getting lots of hugs, you'll love great dogs for sure.
Exactly. Wow, good to know. Thank you for sharing.
Thanks for sharing, and of course, thanks for having us.
Now what? This is, you said Lisa, what's the name?
Barbara.
Okay.
Yeah.
After Barbara Bush.
Yeah, after
That's
Barbara
right.
Bush.
My favorite library in Texas.
Yeah. I love it. And I think she really loves her name. Yeah. We can just play around with it as much as we want. And it's super fun. Yeah. And when we first got her, name was actually Jan. And so we decided to keep
Bush.
That change.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay. Name. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
She's an old lady at heart. She is really sweet.
Yeah,
it's
old lady.
Thank
you. Well, we appreciate you guys coming on, Paris and Isaac, and thank you so much.
Yeah, and believe me, we're going to reach out to you, Paris. You might be doing okay tacos taxes for sure.
Well, look, I would be happy to help. And Conrad, just to make you comfortable, I am so happy looking at your things for absolutely free, right? Your first time having me. I am happy to look over it for you, get your trust, and see what we can work with from there.
Well, that's great. It's nice finally having to in-person meeting with somebody that's informal, and then I feel better about that, you know. We've already established the trust.
For sure.
Instead of walking into some office with no idea.
Right.
Well, I'll send as many people your way. I'll send as many people your way as I can. It's shedoestaxes.com, everybody. Check out Paris's services on her website and on her social media, and we'll be sharing this later today. And thank you guys for coming on.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. You good luck at everything you do.
Thank you so much.
Of course.
Have a good day. All right. Bye-bye.